This is an interview with Mark Manson, who's a difficult man to categorize. He's one of the world's most popular bloggers and author of best-selling anti-self-help books, The Subtle Art of Not Giving a Fuck, and Everything is Fucked, a book about hope. So this was a great conversation. We talked about how most personal growth or self-help misses out on the value of hardship and suffering.
I believe very strongly that Western culture in general has developed an aversion to what I would call healthy struggle, healthy suffering. I truly believe that a certain amount of struggle and suffering is beneficial developmentally, intellectually, physically. And so I think we've lost sight of that.
Mark's background in the world of the pickup artist and how that led him to genuine personal development.
It was extremely formative for me, which is not a popular thing to say right now. I kind of have the feeling that in another like 5 or 10 years, people will actually be very, you know, there'll be a lot more conversations like this, like where people are actually very curious to talk about it because it was such an interesting cultural thing.
And also the story of his relationship with Ken Wilber and integral theory.
So Ken Wilber was hugely influential for me. And I read all of his books when I was in university, and just mind-blowing stuff. Really, really, really incredible synthesis of such like a broad range of ideas, both spiritual and scientific. But, for me, Ken was like very much my first experience in life of like an intellectual hero kind of falling off the pedestal, so to speak.
So today I'm joined by Mark Manson. Mark, I've been a real admirer and reader of your blog and then your books over quite a while. So I'm really pleased that you could join me.
It's great to be here. Thanks for having me.
Just to start off, how would you describe your work?
That's a good question. You know, I actually, one of my favorite descriptions came from a negative review in the Sunday Times, actually over in the UK. The reviewer, I think he was like some cranky 70-year-old guy. And he said, Manson is like the local drunk who spent too much time in the philosophy section. And I was like, yeah, he kind of nailed it. I write wherever my interest takes me, and my interest is predominantly in psychology, self-personal development, dabble in philosophy, social issues, political science, things like that. But it's, it's my roots are in self-help, and kind of I see it as my mission is to, as you put it, subvert the self-help industry and kind of disrupt it a little bit.
And you say disrupt, but that's coming from a place of recognizing that there's a lot of value there as well, I think.
Yeah. I feel like the traditional self-help industry, say of like the late 20th century, like, you know, the 70s up through 2010 or so, I think there's a lot of great stuff about it, but there's just a lot of bullshitty stuff about it too. And so, you know, the goal is to kind of correct and clean up some of the bullshitty stuff, and then also just kind of add my personal zest and flavor to the good stuff.
Yeah, I mean, I feel a sense of similarity in a way, because from the beginning, what I've really wanted with Rebel Wisdom is to kind of frame a lot of these topics. And it's almost difficult to find the language, because self-help, self-development, let alone sort of spirituality or any of that stuff, is like all of the language is played out.
Yeah.
So do you struggle with that? Like, how do you find the right language? How do you find the right idiom? How do you present these ideas in a way that doesn't feel like it's going to set people's alarms off?
Yeah, it's hard. I mean, I sometimes joke when I do speaking is I describe myself as a self-hating self-help guru. because I hate the term. I think there's too many kind of woo-woo irrational connotations with it. It's something that I'm trying to like find a new definition for. You know, I've played with the term negative self-help, you know, kind of like building a self-help based on negativity, on acknowledging pain and struggle and embracing it. Had mixed results, but it's, you know, I honestly don't know what to do with it. It's it's a weird, I do feel like there is kind of an evolution taking place in these spaces where people are becoming more scientific, more rational, more skeptical, less superstitious, but I don't know if we've found like a new term to kind of encapsulate these new ideas.
So how would you, if you were going to give a sort of positive spin on what you are trying to do through your work, how what would you do? I mean, you mentioned sort of science, so it's very much kind of what is proven to work rather than kind of the wishful thinking that you often find in this area, maybe.
Sure. So, you know, a big one is evidence-based. If there is some sort of like psych research on stuff, that's what you should rely on. Not to say that psychology knows what it's doing, but it knows what it's doing more than like the psychic down the street. So that's the first one. The second one I think is more of a cultural value thing. I believe very strongly that Western culture in general has developed an aversion to what I would call healthy struggle, healthy suffering. I truly believe that a certain amount of struggle and suffering is beneficial developmentally, intellectually, physically. And so I think we've lost sight of that. And, you know, a big goal of mine is to bring that into it. And then kind of on a more business side of things, I just think that the old guru model of like a guy standing on stage charging like people's entire life savings to hear him talk for 3 days, like I just think that's really scummy. I think that these are very basic and fundamental ideas, and therefore they should be disseminated as widely as possible, as inexpensively as possible. And so I intentionally adopt business models to do that.
Yeah, and I think you said that you were one of the first to do a subscription model for your site, sort of before everyone was moving on to Substack and places like that. So it's something you've been doing for a while.
Yeah, back, you know, 6-7 years ago, people were charging $200 for an online course, and you'd buy the course, and it's like me sitting in front of it's a guy in front of his laptop for 2 hours just talking, you know, and that felt very scummy. So so I was like, you know, I've got millions of readers, why don't I just ask for $5 a month and, you know, give them a little bit of extra stuff? And you know, and it's worked beautifully. I've been very happy with it.
What would you say is the most either useless or dangerous kind of trends of thinking in the self-help industry? I mean, I think you mentioned The Secret, that kind of manifestation. Would that be one of the things that you'd sort of single out?
Yeah, I think you could call it the law of attraction, but this idea that, you know, it's like thoughts make reality. I think that, and again, it's one of those things, there is a little bit of truth to it. There is a little bit of value to it. You know, it's like we do have cognitive biases. So it's like if I'm thinking all day, every day, you know, that I want to be successful, then my cognitive biases will operate in such a way that I will be more, opportunities will stand out more to me when I see them. So there is a little bit of truth to that. The problem is that there's no nuance. So it's, you know, you've got these theories about universe vibrations and like how the universe wants you to have a new Bentley and you just have to think about it enough. Like it just gets absurd at a certain point. And it also generates a little bit of what I call sometimes like kind of like a spiritual narcissism. It's like when you think that the universe is like listening to your every thought, you know, it can make you into a little bit of a dickhead sometimes. It's like, you know, I prefer to take like, the universe doesn't really give a shit about like what kind of car you want or if you want to raise at work. Like it's you care, right? And it's fine to care, but you need to own that and not create kind of this cosmic belief system out of it. The other thing I see in the self-help world a lot, and I think there's kind of an ethical issue here too, is that self-help itself can become addictive. People that feeling of change or that feeling of discovering a new idea or having a new insight about yourself, you know, like that itself is a dopamine hit. And so it's very easy for people to get sucked into a cycle of always feeling like they need to have some new insight or new tactic or new epiphany or whatever. And there are a lot of companies that feed on that, that keep shoveling that to people. And so one of the things that I consistently say throughout my work is like, hey, sometimes the solution is do nothing. Like sometimes the solution is life sucks, you know, deal with it. And it's always important to have that option available to you, I think.
Yeah, you mentioned that sort of spiritual narcissism side of things. And a friend of mine, Jules Evans, made a really interesting point. So we put out a few films around the conspiracy, sort of rise in conspiracies, and also the link between spirituality and conspiracy. And he said that sort of the secret kind of way of the universe is conspiring and it's all positive and it's everything is laid on a plate for me is the flip side of the other one, which is everything is conspiring. I'm completely powerless. I'm at the mercy of forces. And it was I thought it was a really interesting way of looking at like why do the spiritual or why can the spiritual mindset also become prone to that kind of conspiratorial catastrophizing? And I thought that was a really intelligent way of looking at it.
Yeah, it's super fascinating because I think there's definitely a tendency in people, and I'm trying to remember where I read this, but like, you know, so some people make connections of meaning very easily. So they see perhaps connections or ascribe meaning between two things that there isn't necessarily meaning between two things, you know? So it's like, you know, the stock market crashed and Donald Trump happened to be on an airplane flying to Turkey, you know? And so they assume that there's like a causal connection between those two things. And it's, I've read that, you know, some people who overcreate that meaning or those causal links, a lot of what we experience as kind of like a spiritual realization or spiritual epiphany is ascribing that meaning among like a wide network of instances or interactions that are happening in reality. And then on the flip side of that, some people's brains don't create enough of those causal meanings. So like they don't see the purpose behind something simple as like going to work tomorrow, or they don't see the meaning in like showing up for a friend's birthday party. And those people, the flip side of that is that everything kind of starts to feel bleak and pointless. And that's kind of a more depressive mindset. And so there's like this spectrum of like people who see connections between everything. And so they're not able to like really make good decisions. And then people who see connections between nothing and they, you know, they have trouble getting out of bed in the morning.
Yeah, that's a really interesting way of framing it. I had a lot of interviews on the channel with people talking about meaning and our meaning-making systems and how they can go wrong. Yeah. And this sort of idea that there's almost like it's like an X-axis of meaning. Like you can have too much or we can have too little. And in sort of, I guess, some ecstatic states, they can be incredibly meaningful. And then whatever we perceive in those states is incredibly meaningful. But this sort of idea that, yeah, calibrating our meaning system feels like a really important kind of concept.
Yeah. And it's even if you look at, say, like, you know, mental illness, for instance, you know, if you look at like schizophrenics, like what makes a schizophrenic person schizophrenic is that they see meaning in places that there is no meaning, right? Like they it's like, oh, the garbage man comes on Tuesdays. All the bad things in my life happen on Tuesdays. You know, the garbage man must be making all the bad things happen. You know, it's like they start coming up with weird links and meaning like that. There's like a certain openness that we all need to have to new meaning, but then we also need to be able to like prune possibilities very quickly and easily to narrow in on like the most likely or the most useful meaningful connections. It's a super fascinating topic. It's something I would love to learn more about.
This is a slight segue, but it's still the word meaning. Because I think in your most recent book, you talked about how we've lost this sort of sense of meaning, or we've lost the sense of why that characterized previous generations, which is, I guess, some have called the meaning crisis, that we're in the middle of the meaning crisis for various reasons. How would you frame that? And what do you think Do you have any idea about what the solution could be?
Oh, man. I mean, the overall crisis and meaning, I don't think there's any like single clear explanation for it. We see it demonstrated in all sorts of different vectors. So increasing anxiety and depression and suicide rates and all these things. But it's, you know, some people point at the secularization of culture. You know, it's that lack of religiosity. And sure enough, when you look at religious groups of people, they tend to do much better on a number of like measurements of psychological well-being. So they tend to be happier, depressed less often. They tend to live longer. They tend to have more stable relationships. And so there's kind of this sense that, you know, we need that kind of cosmic purpose in our life to kind of make everything else more possible. Another theory that gets thrown out a lot is, it's called the atomization of culture. So it's people are becoming more independent. More people live alone, fewer people live with family members. Elderly people now live in retirement homes. They don't live with their children when they get old. People are having fewer children, they're having children later. So there's less like strong familial linkages in people's everyday life. And then a theory that I throw out and everything is fucked is that, and this kind of comes back to what we were talking about like making connections between things, is that we're so overloaded with information these days that it's, and there's so many contradictions, like so much of that information is contradictory. So, you know, you read one article today that says, veganism is the healthiest lifestyle. And then like tomorrow you read something that completely contradicts it and you have no idea what to believe anymore. And so because the internet and social media tends to promote things that are contrarian and contradictory, we are all kind of flooded with contradictory information. And because we're flooded with contradictory information, we simply don't know what's meaningful and important anymore. Or it's much more difficult to determine what's meaningful and important.
And I wanted to, in the subtle art, you've got a 10 principles. And among those are happiness is a problem, you're not special, the value of suffering, failure is the way forward, and then you die. And just when you were talking before, when you were framing your philosophy, I was really struck by the similarities with Jordan Peterson. And Jordan Peterson kind of became, and I'm fascinated by Jordan Peterson as a figure and also the phenomenon of Jordan Peterson, like the success of Jordan Peterson as a cultural phenomenon was quite extraordinary. And I think spoke to a lot of the same things that maybe your work is speaking to, like the gritty reality. Like in many ways it was self-help or it was self-improvement, but it was very much framed in life is shitty, you're shitty, you need to get your act together, rather than you can wish yourself into a better world just by thinking that things are going to be better than they are. Are you aware, do you have any thoughts about his work? Were you familiar with it?
you made the distinction between his work itself and then kind of the phenomenon of Peterson. So I was actually very fortunate. His publisher, actually, he reached out. He was very nice and sent me his book before it came out. So I went into his book blind. I didn't really know anything about him. I had maybe heard his name once or twice, that he was a guy on YouTube. And I just started reading the book. And I liked a lot of the book. I would say I probably agree with like 70% of what he says and disagree with like 30%. He's pretty big on the Bible and Book of Genesis, which, you know, I found myself like, all right, get to the point. But that's fine. I mean, he didn't stand out to me any more than, you know, dozens of other authors and books that I read each year, where it's like, oh, I really like this part, didn't really care for that part, that's fine, move on with my life. Then the whole thing blew up and it was like impossible. I think for all of 2018, it was impossible to go anywhere or read anything that didn't talk about him. And I found that fascinating. And, you know, a lot of it perplexing as well, because I didn't find his views to be any more extreme than your average Republican or average, say, pastor at a church in the United States. You know, it's, his views were actually incredibly moderate, in my opinion. They're definitely conservative, but they're moderate. He's very reasonable. He's a very respectable academic psychologist. So it was the disproportionate kind of outcry and scandal around him was a very strange thing to watch. And I don't know if I still kind of fully understand it or why it happened or what happened with it. I imagine if you asked him, he probably doesn't fully understand why it happened. You know, it's just one of those cultural like flashpoints that took off. So it was, you know, Jordan Peterson, the work itself, I would say I'm a mild fan. I like it. I don't love it. But in terms of just a cultural phenomenon, I found it fascinating. Really fascinating.
Yeah. Yeah. He kind of became a one man lightning rod for the culture war for 2018, yeah. Pretty much. And there's other similarities, or you've talked about presenting your work in a way that will, won't trip the tripwires for men in particular, that a lot of the work in this genre is often kind of directed or seemingly direct is if not directed towards women, is at least done in a way that makes it less accessible to men. Could you outline why you think that is?
Well, I think culturally it was, until recently, it culturally was never really acceptable for men to think about their emotional health or their mental health. Traditionally, when you look throughout the history of the self-help industry, it was, the women's advice was always relationships and feelings, and the men's advice was always make money, become more successful. And it never really crossed over. And then, you know, starting around 10 or 20 years ago, it began to cross over. You know, you started to get more women showing up at make money seminars, and you started to get more men showing up at, you know, seminars about feelings and personal development and stuff. So it's definitely something, I think, starting particularly with my generation, like the millennial generation, I think there's been a demand for it among men. And I know you want to get into the pickup artist thing. And I think a large reason why the pickup artist thing happened is because there was a whole generation of men that craved that kind of information, but it just wasn't being presented to them in a way that was enticing or exciting to them. And I think coming from that community and that industry, my work was very, just naturally very well. And just being a guy, you know, 30-year-old guy myself, who cares very deeply about my emotional health, you know, I was positioned very well to reach out to those guys and communicate with them. So typical in the self-help industry, you know, it's understood to be like 75-25 or 80-20 women to men. My readership is around 60-40 or 55-45, depending on kind of where you look.
And you've said that you think men are more sensitive to the phoniness in the self-help genre.
I think so. I think men are just more skeptical of it in general. You know, I just think, and again, it's part, a lot of it's probably partially cultural, is, you know, men are just skeptical of anything involving like dealing with feelings. You know, it's like, is that true? Or are you just trying to get a buck, you know? And so you kind of have to win them over. Whereas I think, you know, with women, most women who come to my work, you know, they've been reading books, self-help books already. They've been reading magazines and websites and stuff already. So it's like, you don't really need to win them over. If the advice is good, they'll read it. It's the men that you kind of have to convince that you're not full of shit.
But you've also said that then often the men are more grateful for your work than the women.
Yeah, I've found, so for instance, like I did a speaking tour last year, in about 20 different cities. And I found that the audience, it was usually like 2/3 women, 1/3 men, but the composition of who came up to me afterwards to shake my hand and thank me and get a picture and everything, it was probably 2/3 men, 1/3 women. So it's generally, if somebody comes to me and they're like, you changed my life, you know, oh my God, let me tell you about what happened to me. And then I found your book. Like it's more often it's men who say stuff like that, which is interesting. Yeah.
And there's something I wonder if you have a thought on, but it's something that's come up quite a lot. So for about 2 or 3 years, I've been leading men's retreats on and off. And something that I've heard a lot, especially from the younger men, is this sort of weird catch 22. So I think a lot of, I'm actually amazed at how emotionally connected they often are. Like we do a lot of kind of we introduce different topics and they talk about those, and generally they're pretty well connected. But what a lot of them talk about is that they feel this weird catch 22 where they're both encouraged to be more vulnerable, to be more open, to share their feelings, and being told that they're taking too much space at the same time. And a lot of them find it very hard to kind of work out how to show up, or how they feel both shut down and encouraged at the same time.
Yeah, it's still a weird time in that, you know, a lot of the cultural norms around this stuff, it's still shifting. And so I think what doesn't get talked about a lot, and actually Brené Brown talks about this in one of her books, when she talks about vulnerability, she talks about the double standard that a lot of women have, which is, you know, they complain that men are so emotionally closed off, or they don't, you know, they never open up. But then as soon as a man opens up, they're like, wow, you're such a pussy, like man up or whatever, you know? And so I think there's a kind of a co-evolution. I mean, I think this is true with all these gendered issues, you know, the same thing with feminism, how there has to be kind of like a co-evolution among men of learning to work with women in the workplace and understand certain expectations are going to shift and change. I think there's also a co-evolution that has to happen with women in terms of men opening up and expressing their feelings more. You know, some women are on board with that and they understand it, and they're going to give space and they're going to respect it. Some women are not on the vulnerability train, you know, and so they're going to be less understanding, or they're going to be turned off by it. And, you know, the thing I try to get men to understand is that, you know, it's, you don't need, the goal here is not that everybody likes you or that every woman likes you. The goal here is to find the one or the few women that you enjoy being around, you know? So it's like rejection is an expected part of the process. Finding women who, when you share yourself, they're turned off by it, that's part of the process. Like, you need that to happen now so that you can go find somebody else, rather than spending 3 years with them and then finding out 3 years from now, when you finally open up, that they're the wrong person for you, you know? So it's good that these things happen immediately and quickly, even if it's uncomfortable.
Yeah, this feels like a really good opportunity to shift to the pickup artist conversation. But just before that, I think Brené Brown also talks about this in her second. So she did that amazing vulnerability talk, and then she did a follow-up about shame. And she tells that story in that about how she was only studying women and then suddenly started, or then kind of added men and started studying men, and realized that it showed up very differently. Vulnerability and shame showed up very differently in men and women. I really highly encourage everyone to go and watch that. I thought it was an amazing talk. And if anyone's watching this and knows Brené Brown, do put in a word. I'd love to interview her. I've already reached out to her people, and she seems very busy. But yeah. The pickup artist. So my fascination here is I've seen this come up quite a few times. So we talk a lot about different practices here, like authentic relating and circling and these kind of relational practices. And I found quite a few of the trainers now teaching that come from this background where they initially started doing pickup artistry. Probably the sort of manipulative, very kind of, we can talk a little bit about that. But then they kind of found that actually what they wanted to do was to become better men, to learn more relational skills. And I'm fascinated by that kind of history of where, and I'd say I put you squarely in that tradition, that you were a dating coach, And then you expanded out and became more about kind of how can you become a better man, how you can become a better person. Can you talk about that trajectory? Have you seen it elsewhere in people that maybe you knew back then?
I run into former pickup people all the time. And it's crazy because it's a lot of them are doing very well in other industries right now. And it's usually industries related to kind of life coaching or seminars or self-help or whatever. And it doesn't really surprise me. I often describe that whole thing that happened from kind of 2005 to 2010 as a very well-intentioned but horribly misguided experiment, which is, I think, you know, men looking back, every man goes through a period in their life where like they want to find a girlfriend, they want to find a wife, or they want to get laid, whatever. And they have no idea how to go about it. They have no idea how to talk to girls. They're scared, you know, super nervous. They embarrass themselves. And that's a huge pain point that needs to be relieved, you know, and we all kind of have to go through it at some point. And the pickup thing was kind of amazing because the internet, for the first time, usually men went through that process alone, or we went through it with our friends, or maybe if we were lucky, we had a father who was really helpful and like giving us some pointers. But the internet for the first time allowed all those men to come together and kind of experiment and treat it as like a lab, you know, kind of like create a lab for themselves. So like, well, what if you say this? What if you act this way? Like, hey, I wore this weird shirt and I got laid last night, you know? And so it was this kind of crazy experimental thing that went on. And I think for the most part, I've described it as 90% of it was ignorant. You know, it was a lot of nerds or overachieving guys who had just not been socialized enough, who didn't know what they were doing. And to know what you're doing, you need to do some stupid or bad things occasionally, you know, be an asshole occasionally to discover that, oh, wait, I'm an asshole, and then go do something else. I would say maybe 10% was like genuinely like nefarious and bad intentions, misogynistic, you know, that sort of thing. And so there was early on, I think there was just such a kind of an excitement of trying and discovering new things and growing together that people didn't really think a whole lot about it. But I think as the years went on, it soon became clear what worked and what didn't work. And basically there were like two things that worked. One is actually improve yourself as a man, like become a really awesome man. Basically, it's like, that's strategy number one. Strategy number two is become incredibly manipulative and go after highly insecure women. That also works, but it's unethical, right? So from my vantage point, I think starting around like 2009, 2010, it was very clear to me that there was a schism happening in the two camps, and they were going their separate ways. And I would say probably 70-80% was going kind of the healthy personal development route, and 20-25% was going down the like the dark manipulative path. And that the latter path eventually became the red pill community, became the men going their own way community, became the incel community, became like the very like dark basement of internet subcultures. But then that 75% that kind of went the healthy route, they you know, it turned into men's groups and retreats and businesses like mine, where it's, you know, it's gender neutral and we talk to everybody. And it's because ultimately it's like there's nothing gender specific about dating and relationship advice. Like 99% of dating and relationship advice that works, it's not gender specific. You know, it's like have self-respect, communicate your values, you know, be social, meet a lot of people, state your intentions, seek consent. Like, it's not fucking rocket science. So So I think at a certain point, it was inevitable that a men's community didn't make sense anymore.
Were you aware of some of those practices like circling, authentic relating, or any of those particular kind of relational skills that people developed?
You mean within the pickup scene or before the pickup scene?
Since. I mean, I've seen it a lot in people who are now teaching sort of those kind of skills, those more relational skills.
Yeah, I think it's something that was just kind of discovered, at least for me personally, it was discovered through the process of going through the pickup artist thing. So, you know, very early on, you got to remember too, I got into it when I was 20, you know? So like, I never really had any like social experience as an adult, you know, before then. So I had nothing else to fall back on. It was like, I basically learned how to be a social adult through my experiences in the pickup community. But like very early on when I got into the scene, there was kind of a split between people who believe that you kind of had to figure out your best three or four stories and your best three or four lines and go and say those to everybody. And then there was kind of a school of thought that was like, no, you shouldn't have to do that. You should, you know, if you respect yourself, you should simply be able to say whatever you mean or whatever you want. There's all, you know, also kind of that first school of thought, there was this idea that you had to like hide your intentions from women. Like you couldn't tell them, you couldn't let them know that you thought they were attractive or that you were like, you know, romantically interested in them. You had to like kind of play this game around them, you know, whereas this other school of thought was like, no, you just tell them. And if it's a good fit, they'll respond well, you know? And I quickly learned that latter, that more honest and open approach, not only seemed more effective for me, just kind of tactically, but it felt better. Like I was happier doing it. Like it's memorizing lines and stuff, or like portraying yourself in a certain, like it feels like a job, you know? Like it feels like you're like an actor or something. And that's not fun. Whereas like actually meeting a girl who likes you and then saying that to her, like that's fun. It's exciting. So for me early on, it was just, I discovered that my emotions should be my compass through this whole thing. It's not about, you know, I think men, again, it's very, you know, men tend to look at things algorithmically. They're like, okay, well, I want this result. So, you know, let's figure out X, Y, Z variables that will produce X, you know, that result. And a lot of the pickup guys applied that same thinking to their romantic interactions. And for me, it was like very early on, I realized like, no, if I'm not happy, like what's the point in dating somebody if you're not happy dating them, you know? So it's like happiness needs to be the result. Everything else needs to flow downstream from that.
Yeah, I'm interested a little bit more in like, what was your personal journey through it? Or what was your personal journey through that community and then out into your work now? Like, what do you think you learned from it? Or how did you personally develop?
It was extremely formative for me, which is not a popular thing to say right now. I kind of have the feeling that in another like 5 or 10 years, people will actually be very, you know, there'll be a lot more conversations like this, like where people are actually very curious to talk about it, because it was such an interesting cultural thing. But I think, you know, given Me Too and a lot of the cultural trends the last few years, which many of them are justified, you know, it's looked at as a very skeezy, shameful thing to talk about. But for me, it was extremely formative. And I was the nerdy guy in high school. Girls didn't really like me, you know, repeatedly rejected by every girl I ever had interest in. Got to college, got my first girlfriend, fell madly in love. She ended up cheating on me and leaving me for another guy, you know? So I was a sob story in the romance department up until I was 20, 21. And then, you know, a couple months after my girlfriend left, I found The Game by Neil Strauss. And, you know, as a guy who had basically zero experience, romantic experience, other than that one girlfriend who grew up in Texas. So, you know, I grew up with a lot of conservative views around gender and gender norms and stuff like that. Like, to me, those were normal and expected. You know, to me, it just seemed like a logical thing to pursue. And it wasn't until I got into it, that I started realizing that a lot of these assumptions and behaviors have side effects or consequences, or, you know, for instance, like the way you behave when you first meet somebody often sets the tone for the entire relationship. So if you're meeting women in parties and clubs and you're drunk and they're drunk and it's all about sex, like that sets a kind of precedent for your future interactions with the person and for how they understand you and who you are. And so if you actually do want to have a girlfriend or have a deeper emotional connection, that can actually create barriers for you. You know, it took me years to figure that out, but it was kind of that experimental mindset. I still, you know, I will argue to my death that the experimental or kind of scientific mindset as applied to approaching one's social life or relationship life, not treating other people as experiments, but treating yourself as an experiment, you know, asking yourself, oh, if I go out tonight and I try to be more open, or if I try to listen more, or if I try to ask these sorts of questions, what will happen to my social interactions? I think that's a very healthy thing for people to adopt. I think it's a very useful thing for people to adopt. I think where you get into trouble is when you start treating other people as the hypothesis and as the experiment, which a lot of pickup people did. And it was creepy, you know, but I think, you know, Carol Dweck has that thing about growth mindset and fixed mindset. And I feel like culturally, at least for me, you know, when I look back at me in high school or kind of just the culture in general in the 80s and 90s, it was like, you were either born cool or you're born a nerd. Like there was nothing you could do about it. And I think what was really liberating and amazing about pickup was it got rid of that fixed mindset about like social status and social skills, and it replaced it with a growth mindset, which is like, no, you can have a great social life. You can have great relationships. You can get laid like tile if you want. You just have to learn certain social skills, and you have to learn to be with people and interact with people and develop emotional intelligence. Like these are all things that you can work on and improve. And to me that's incredibly liberating. And I think that gets lost, you know, with all like the kind of the shady stuff that went on.
Yeah, it's a really interesting way of, I mean, you called it a growth mindset. You could also call it a developmental mindset. Yeah. And I guess you're saying that it might be possible in 5 years, 10 years time that people will look back and say that what it actually did amongst all of the bad behavior and amongst all of the kind of sleazy stuff was brought a whole lot of people into thinking of life in a developmental way.
I think so. And I also think ultimately men in general came out healthier for it, because again, it made these conversations more acceptable, and it once the industry or the leaders within the industry, once we all kind of found the healthy answers, it made those healthy answers more socially acceptable for guys to pursue. You know, so it's like, I wrote my dating book, which is called, it's called Models Attract Women Through Honesty. You know, at the time when I wrote it, it was very contrarian. It was very like, When I wrote it specifically to contradict a lot of the slimy advice I saw being given in that industry. My goal when I wrote it was simply to kind of clean up, you know, to like show guys like, hey, no, that's emotionally unhealthy. And by the way, it's also disrespectful to women, and it's going to produce bad relationships. it's, you know, these days it's been, I think it's been the top selling men's dating book on Amazon for like 6 years straight now. Like it's, I get women who read it, find a lot of useful advice in it, and then go and buy it for their brothers and their nephews and cousins. And it's amazing. So it's, I think as shady as it, that whole trend feels now, I've always argued that it's been a net positive on culture. It's made men better. Not because it was good, but because it showed us what not to do.
Yeah. It kind of reminds me of, like, I've seen the same trajectory from a lot of people who find, like, they start doing business coaching. They get into something like Tony Robbins, which is very much sort of success driven. But then over time, they start getting more into kind of more relational stuff or more therapeutic stuff. And that trajectory I see, like, I say a lot of it's sort of very egoic, but then they find other practices or they find other work that is much more about maybe, yeah, relations or your spirituality or other kind of more deeper sense of who we are.
Yeah, I agree. And I think the reason for that is that it's, those things are very transactional. You know, so it's like the idea that I'm going to go buy a Neil Strauss book and it's going to get me laid. Like it's a very, he's going to tell me what to say. And then those words are going to, you know, get me laid. Like that's a very transactional mindset. It's an idea of like, okay, if I just do A, B, and C, then like this result. And it's the same thing with the success and make money advice. You know, it's people buy those books because they're like, I want to have more money. So just tell me what to do. I'll go do it. And then I'll have more money. And one of the things I write about in Everything is Fucked and I write about on my website a lot is that transactional mentality, like there's a limit to it. Like it can't make you happy. It's the transactional mentality is it's a treadmill, you know? So even if you get laid that once, you need to get laid again to be happy again. Even if you make money once, you need to make more money to be happy again. And so the only way to break out of that transactional mindset is to get to a place of what I call like unconditional values. So things that can't be transacted. So for instance, trust is something like you can't manipulate your way to trust. Like it's self-contradictory. Respect is the same way. You can't force people to respect you. You can't force people to love you, or you can't trick people into loving you, at least not long-term. And so it's, you begin to discover that the things that actually make life meaningful and bring joy and happiness to your life, they can't be bargained. You can't transact for them. But I think the only way you have that realization is when you try to get really good at the transactions and you realize that they fail. Like they're not working. I'm making this money. I'm not happy. I'm getting laid. I'm not happy. What am I doing wrong? It's like, oh, I should just give up. You know, and just be with people and find, you know, it's like the old cliche, the best things in life are free. It's not that they're free. It's just that they can't be paid for. They can't be bought.
Is that the meaning of one of your other kind of aphorisms, which is just give up?
Yeah. Or the opening of Subtle Art, I say, don't try, which is it's, because it's if you're in the mindset of trying, it's like, look, you either do something or you don't. It's the old Yoda thing, right? It's like you either do something or you don't. And it's if you're stuck in this mode of like, I'm trying to make money, I'm trying to get laid, I'm trying to have more friends or be more popular, what you're doing is you're setting up an algorithm in your brain, a transaction in your brain, where it's like, if I can just achieve X, then I will be happy. And it's like, it does not work that way. It does not, like, because as soon as you get X, there's another X in front of you, and it just never ends. Like that's just how the mind works. And so it's the only way to really get there is to just drop it. You know, it's like, it's okay to make money, but just go make money. Don't make money because you think you'll be happy. Make money because you're doing something that's really enjoyable that makes money. You know, like it's that simple.
Yeah. And I mentioned the idea of the developmental mindset before. And I just want to, before we finish, talk about the Ken Wilber article that you wrote, which I, it was the first one that I read that was written in a popular style that really felt like you named a lot of the issues with, like, it came from a place of like great admiration and great kind of love for a lot of Ken's work, but also a sense of like, this didn't really succeed. Like, it was a very ambitious project that didn't succeed. Could you summarize that? Because I know you've got quite a background with this stuff.
So Ken Wilber was hugely influential for me. And I read all of his books when I was in university. And just mind-blowing stuff. Really, really, really incredible synthesis of such like a broad range of ideas, both spiritual and scientific. And I to this day, I continue to recommend him to anybody who's interested. But for me, Ken was like very much my first experience in life of like an intellectual hero kind of falling off the pedestal, so to speak. You know, it's like I really, when I was young, and a lot of this is just being young and naive, but like I really kind of put him on a pedestal of like, man, if there's one person who's got this figured out, it's this guy, right? He's so smart and he's read all this stuff. And then kind of watching him in his institute slowly unwind through the early 2000s was very deeply interesting to me, but also a little bit heartbreaking. And so that piece, that article, it's also on YouTube if people want to go listen to it. It was almost like an elegy, you know, like it was kind of like paying homage to this guy, but also saying goodbye. And it's interesting because what he taught me that was so powerful, and I think I've benefited from so much since then. You know, Ken Wilber's whole thing was he called it the integral theory. So it's like he literally took every field of study and mapped it out into a model and showed how they all related to each other. So how biology relates to political systems and how those relate to economic systems, how those relate to inner phenomenology and spiritual epiphanies and transpersonal awareness and like all this stuff. Like it's all in there. He finds a way to kind of make all the puzzle pieces fit. And the fascinating thing is that his own theory kind of predicts that, you know, it's all of the downfalls and all the negative things that ended up happening, you know? So his theory should have predicted that, you know, cultural progress is not linear. It does loop-de-loops. Sometimes it goes into recessions or depressions. Sometimes it regresses. Sometimes you cannot create an institution that can account for all variables or vectors. You know, it's like generally every time we've tried to control nature in a certain way or control, say, the economy in a certain way, it backfires in a lot of unintended ways. You know, yet he plunged head. And the amazing thing about him, too, is he spent the first 30 years of his career refusing to do anything other than write books because he said this. He said, I don't want to be a guru. I don't want to be a figurehead. I don't want to have a bunch of money. Like, I don't want to manage people's money and try to build something. Like, he's like, I just want to write books. And then that flipped in the 90s and he created Integral Institute and started creating all these seminars and movements and activism and stuff like that. And within, you know, 5-10 years, it all fell apart. And it fell apart for the exact ways that, you know, pretty much everybody would predict it would, which is, you know, it's just mismanagement, too much ego, not practical, things like that. And so the piece kind of sums all that up. And for me, the big lesson was like, okay, well, if this can happen to this guy, you know, we're all hosed, right? And it's something that I definitely try to keep in mind in my own work, in my own career, which, you know, at the beginning of the interview, I said, like, I don't ever want to be that guy on stage charging $5,000 a head, you know, for that reason. It's because there's no way for me to get it right for everybody. And I mean, hell, I struggle to get it right for me, you know? So it's like, how the hell am I going to get it right for you or for somebody else? So I go through many pains to remove my own values from my work as much as I can. You know, it's for me, the goal is to help other people ask very important questions of themselves to discover their own values and identities. It's not about me kind of pushing my values and identities on the people or claiming that, you know, my method or framework is like the one true way and it's going to change your life forever. It's like, no, it's a tool. Some tools are useful. Some are not. Some tools are useful for a lot of people and not others, you know? So it's, that's it, you know? I try to keep myself at that kind of level of humility, not just for my sake, but everybody's sake.
So you're not going to create the fucked institute?
No. No, but it would be amusing if I did. Maybe I'll create like a satirical institute, like the fucked institute. It's just, we do nothing but create white papers and research on meaningless things.
And just the last question, because I know you've sort of talked about potentially leaving this genre or going doing something else in the future. Do you have any sense of what that might be?
Well, I've told my agent that at some point before I'm old and gray, I would like to write a novel at some point. I don't know if anybody would read it, but at this point, it's one of those things that it's like, if I never do it, it's like that. If I don't do it, I'm always going to regret not doing it. So if, just for that reason, I have to do it, even if like only my mother and my wife read it. But yeah, I mean, it's one of the, there's a pull with this career and that like the more success you get, the more you kind of want to protect it and maintain it. And there are a lot of business ways to do that. And one internal struggle that I consistently have with myself is to keep my creative options open. You know, it's like, I always want to be able to put myself in a position where if setting all of this self-help stuff aside for 5 years and going and doing something else is what's going to make me feel the most happy and fulfilled, like I want to be able to do that. I don't want to feel stuck by my, you know, by the Mark Manson method or whatever, like, or having a staff of 25 coaches under me. Like, you know, it's just not, you know, I'm always resisting that. So, you know, we'll see. We'll see what happens.
Awesome. It's been a great conversation. Thank you for making the time for it. Was there anything more you wanted to say before we conclude?
No. Check out the books. I've got a weekly newsletter at the website, Mindfuck Mondays. You can sign up at markmanson.net/newsletter. That's it. Awesome.
Rebel Wisdom isn't only about the ideas in the films. It's also about how we bring them into our lives, which is why over the last few months, we've invested in developing the Rebel Wisdom community, our digital campfire. We've launched a new platform for discussion and connection, started regular meetups and practice sessions for members, plus Q&As with some of the amazing interviewees we've had on the channel, and our Wisdom Gym with some of the biggest names in growth and transformation. So if you'd like to support Rebel Wisdom to help us continue to make films and to find the others, maybe think about joining the Rebel Wisdom community. Thank you for watching.